Hi there once again, and welcome to another Expresso Mechanic tutorial. And in this one, we're going to be looking at the formula node and what we might be able to achieve with that. Essentially, what we're going to do, we're going to be starting by creating a damped sine wave, and then we're also going to look at the possibility of creating sine and other types of waves which can be animated. And if you've done the oscilloscope tutorial and you don't actually have Mograph, maybe you're working in an earlier version of Cinema, or perhaps Cinema 4D Prime or something like that still, and you don't actually have Mograph, then I'm going to show you how you can create a spline that will be able to be used in the oscilloscope anyway. So, you know, you're not being left out. Right, so let's see what we've got on the screen. Well, I've got a sweep NURBS, and I'm just sweeping a circle along a spline. The spline has 32 points. If we just go into the structure, we've got 0 to 31. So we've got 32 points on the spline. And at the moment, we've just got a null object, which I've labeled Expresso. For obvious reasons, I'm going to be using this to put an Expresso tag on. And I've just got a couple of notes here, and these are the formulae for the splines that I'm going to be creating. So we're going to be looking at those in a little while. But for now, let's just add the Expresso tag and get things underway. That's great. First thing we need to do is drag our spline into the Expresso window there, and we can give that an object port. Next thing we need is a point node. So we'll just get one of those. And we can connect our object port from the output of the spline to the input, or the object port on the input of the point node. And that's the first thing. Now with this point node, the only thing we actually need is the point count. We're not interested in anything else. So moving on from here, we'll grab an iteration, because that's what we need to do. We need to iterate through the points, and we can then move this over here and put our point count into the iteration end. And that's as much as we need to do. So the iteration starts at zero and then counts through all of the points. So that's exactly what we needed to do. The next node we're going to need is a math divide. So we'll get one of those. Just change the function to a divide. If we go into our node there, change that to divide. Okay. And we can connect our iteration to the first input there at the top there, input number one. Now is the all important node. This is the one that we really need. This is the most important one of all, which is the formula node. So if we come down to calculate formula. Now this is a node that we need to define the inputs for. You can just use it as is. You can just put a formula into here and just output that here. But we need to go a little bit further. In fact, quite a bit further with this, because we're going to use it to, well, as a controller, basically, for everything that we're going to create here. So we're going to give it some ports. The first one we're going to give it, we've got, it says just value. That's what you get as standard. But we can rename these, and I'm going to rename them as I go along. So I'm going to call this one amplitude. And I'm going to add another 5 ports, so I might as well just add those. And then make our formula bigger. So now we've got 6 ports. The next one is going to be decay. You'll understand this a bit later, it will all make sense. So decay, we'll just put that one in there. The next one is going to be frequency. Moving on from here, we call the next one wavelength, and the next one is going to be phase shift. Not O phase shift, just phase shift. Okay, and then finally, this one is going to be time, and we're going to use that to animate any waves that we choose to. So I'll rename that one time. And moving on from here, we can just grab a time node. A time node is what we're going to need to plug into at that bottom input there. So we might as well set that up now. Okay, so that's all done. Just change that back to 100%, that's better. Moving on from here, I'm going to bring in a math multiply, so I'm going to copy this over here. Change the function to multiply. And we're going to take our iteration value and plug that into the first input there. And then the multiply for now, I'm going to put at 50. And this is going to be used to actually space the points out along this axis, okay, along the x-axis. So it'll give us a length. It's kind of a scaling value for the length of our waveform that we're going to be generating. Next port of call for us is going to be an adapter, and it's going to be vector to reals. So we need to get one of those and take the output from our formula and plug it into the input there. And then the next node that we need is going to be a reals to vector. And we can plug our Y value, or our Y vector, I should say, into there. Well, it's a real value, I suppose. It's a, that's we need to plug into there. And we need to plug our math multiply into the X. The Z we're going to leave at zero. So our Z axis here, we don't need to play around with that. It can just stay at zero because we're only interested in the Y axis and, of course, what's going on in the X. So that's what we've got plugged in there. And then finally, what we need is another point node. So we can either generate a new one or just copy this one, and we might as well just copy this one. So I'll bring this one across here. Once again, I need to have my spline as my object. I need to plug that into there. The point index is going to be the iteration value. So we'll take that and plug it into there. Move that out of the way a little bit there and move this over here. And then finally the point position. So we need to plug the vector value here into the point position. And that's everything we need to, for the moment anyway, to complete this expression. The only thing we need to do is to plug our divide for now into the frequency. That's as much as we're going to do for now. I've got to put a division value in there, and I'm going to just say 0.5 in there. And that's as much as I'm going to do. So the expression is now set up and it's actually working. Of course, nothing's happening at the moment because we need to give the formula node some figures. So what do we need to do? Well, the amplitude we can set up at 500. We've also, of course, got to put a formula in here, which we haven't done yet, but we'll put that as 500. The decay I'm going to put at 0.1, the wavelength at 0.1, and I'm going to leave the phase shift for the moment at 0. Don't need to worry about that too much at the moment. So they're the figures I'm going to initially put in there. The next thing to do is to get a formula into the formula field there. So let's just have a look, see what we've got. Now, I said that we'd start with a damped sine wave, and that's the bottom one here. So I'm going to grab this out of here and paste it into the formula there. Okay, and that's that done. Now we've got an issue. Let's just see what the issue is. So I've got decay, I've got frequency, I've got wavelength, and I've got phase shift. Okay, so I've got all that in there. Let's have a quick look, see what we've got. We want to use, I think I know what the problem is actually, is that I haven't checked use port names. There you go. As soon as I switch it on, we get a damped sine wave. It generates perfectly well. So what might you use this for? Well, I suppose if you brought, say, a text spline in there, you might use it as the basis for a logo. And we do have quite a lot of control over the art direction of this already, actually. If we go into the formula here, we can change the amplitude level, so we can bring that up and down. With the multiplier here, we can scale the length of the waveform there, so we've got that control over it. We can, you know, we can do various things with it at the moment. As I say, just using these controls, we can change this to 0.2 and it will it changes the decay length there. And obviously we can go a lot higher. We can go to stupid lengths if we want to. You mustn't go below 0.1 though, or you don't want to go too far because you'll crash the computer if you do. That's something I found out, so don't do that. the wavelength, we can change that if we wish to, and it does actually behave a little bit like a frequency control on this occasion, possibly because we're using a damped sine wave. I'm not really sure, but it does appear to be very similar to frequency, even though it's wavelength. So there's quite a lot you can do with the art direction of this. I mean, you know, this could be a logo for a, I don't know, you could call it, what could we call it? I don't know, let's have a look. We could call it, it could be a radio show, couldn't it? I don't know, you could say, I don't know, radio, or a new wave radio or something like that. I don't know, new wave radio would be quite good, wouldn't it? New wave radio, FM or something. you know, that could be put there and scale that down, and it can be a logo type, you know, so it'll be quite good for that. And again, as I say, you can, using the art direction, you can change the look of the actual wave until it fits the actual logo in the way that you want it to. Could, I don't know, change the actual wavelength, make it bigger, make it smaller, do whatever you like, really. But it could be used for that kind of thing, and you can just art direct it in any way you wish to. So that's the first way that we can use this. We just take the text away. So the second way is to use it, as I said, in a sort of use it for animated waves. So what we'll do now, if we go back into the formula, we can remove this one, and we'll put the other waveform in there. Just copy that one and put it back in there. And now we should get a different kind of wave. We won't get anything initially because we've got to run the timeline, because it's using the time to actually generate the wave. So here we go. And straight away we start to get a sine wave. And you'll find that it will behave in an interesting sort of way. And as I said, you can put this, let's just give us a few more frames actually so that we can see how this develops. As I said, you can put this, if you just take the spline here and put it in the texture, as I showed you how to do in the oscilloscope tutorial, that's all you need to do, and then you'll get a waveform on your oscilloscope screen without needing Mograph. So, you know, there is a way around it. You're not lost if you haven't got Mograph. You can still generate a nice sort of waveform for your oscilloscope. So that's all looking pretty good, and it works okay. However, it would be nice if we could have all of these controls, and probably the scale control, controlled by user data. And that's the next thing I'm going to actually do. I'm going to build something to actually do that. So if we grab a null and we call this controller, what we'll do is start putting user data on this. So if we go to add user data, the first one is going to be amplitude, then we'll move on to decay, frequency, wavelength, phase shift, and finally I'll add a scale control as well. So we're going to have six controls altogether. So let's just start. So if we call this amplitude, and we want a float slider for this, I'm going to use that because it's a great way of doing it. We want real values. We want steps of one should be fine, I think, for the step value there. That should be perfectly good. I'm going to put these as minimum and maximum. I might as well check those. I think we'll start with 100 as the minimum wavelength, and we'll go to 500 for the maximum. And I think we'll start by splitting the difference and saying 300 in there for the initial wavelength. So that one is complete. Let's add another one, call this decay. Okay, again, float slider, real value. And this we're going to go in steps of 0.1. We'll start as a minimum value. Again, I'll clamp those values at 0.1 because we don't want to go below that. Otherwise, we crash the computer if we're not careful. And I think we'll go to a maximum of just 11. I think that's kind of artistically what works best, I think, for me. And we'll start with an initial value of 0.1. That should be perfectly good for that. Add another user data, call this one frequency, add a float slider for that one, make it a real value. With this, we'll start with, or still we'll use steps of 0.1. We'll start with a minimum value of 0.1 and we'll go to just 3 for this, I think is more than enough. If you don't agree, by all means change it, but I'm going to go to 3. And I'm going to start with 0.5 as my initial frequency value there. Okay, so that one's done. Add another user data. Call this one wavelength. It's going to be a float slider once again and a real value. And again, we'll use steps of 0.1. We'll start with a minimum value of 0.1. And again, clamp these values. And a maximum value, I think, for wavelength of, what should we go for? I think, what did I do on frequency? Let's have a look. I'll tell you what, frequency, I did that slightly wrong. I should have put 11 in there. That's what that should have been. What about decay? I've put decay as 11. That should have been actually 1. I've got a bit ahead of myself. I'm looking at my notes and I've got a bit ahead of myself there. Okay, so that's those sorted out for you there. So wavelength should be 3. That's fine. Yeah, so that's absolutely perfect. And the initial value for wavelength, I'm going to leave at 0.1. That should be fine for that. So I've got 0.5 for my frequency, that's correct. 1 for my decay, which should actually, yeah, no, 0.1 for there. That's for, yeah, that's all good, it's all good, it's all working okay. Just wanted to be sure there. Okay, next data, we want the phase shift. Again, we want a float slider. We want a real value. And we want to, well, what we're going to do here, I'm going to say steps of 1, and I'm going to start that at minus 100, finish it at 100, and set it at 0 for the default value. That's absolutely fine. And then finally, I just need a scale. So if we add data, call it scale. And what I'm going to do here is, this is a multiplier value. Again, we're going to use a float slider. We're going to say it's a real value. Again, I'll use a step of 1 because that's absolutely fine. And I'm going to start it at a minimum value of 10 and put 300 as the maximum. That's quite a lot, actually. And, it, you know, again, change it to your own tastes if it's not good enough. And 50, I'm going to start as the default value. Okay, and then clamp those values. And that's everything done on the controller. So that should be working perfectly well. So moving on from here, all we need to do is bring this into our Expresso window there, go down to user data and just add all of the outputs. Frequency, wavelength, phase shift, scale, wavelength in there. Okay, that's great. So just bring those out. Now the wavelength, I'm just going to move under frequency there so that we get it in the right place, he says. Yeah, that's better. Okay, great. And then all we need to do is start plumbing these in, so we can put that one in there. The decay can go here. The frequency has got to go through the divide, so where I've got the divide set up with 0.5, I've got to put the frequency in there now and replace that. So that's fine. The wavelength goes in the wavelength. The phase shift in the phase shift, of course. And then finally, the scale I'm going to put in the multiplier there. OK, so everything is set up. Now, what I can do, if we can just run the timeline, I'll just move this. Actually, what I'll do, I'll shut this down. I think I can always open it up again if there's any issues with it. But let's go into the controller. So we've got the user data all set up there. It's all waiting for us to use. So let's see what we get. So everything's working OK. So if we just stop that for a second there, and if we play with our amplitude, we can see that it does work. It's doing the job for us. The decay won't, because we're not using it on this particular sine wave there. We're not using it there, so we don't use that. The frequency, we can change that, so we can shorten double the amount of, or treble the amount even of waveforms there. So that's all working fine. The wavelength should be working, or should it? No, I don't think we use, do we use wavelength on this? I don't know whether we do or not. I don't think we do on this particular, have a look, see what we've got here. No, we don't use wavelength. We're not using it. So we're not using it on this particular wave at all. So that doesn't do anything on this one. We'll put the other waveform back in a minute and see what we can do with that. So the wavelength isn't doing anything. The phase shift will, that'll just move it up and down as you might wish to. And then the scale will make it longer or shorter. Okay. So that all works perfectly well. Right then, let's bring back the original damped sine wave and see what we can do with that. Just open this up and move our formula up there. Let's take that down there. Right, okay, good. So let's just go and get the damped sine wave from here. Grab a hold of that. And drop that in there. Okay, so we're back to where we were. That's looking good. So in our formula here, we can now use our, well, actually we don't need to use that anymore, do we? We need a controller. So in the controller, we've now got control over what this is going to look like, and we can art direct this really well. Let's just bring that text back so that we've got the logo. We'll just lower that down a bit there. So, you know, with, we can just phase shift that and take it down a little bit more if we wanted a little bit of a gap between the lettering there. There's so many things we can do. You know, we can change the decay. We can art direct this to our heart's content, actually. It looks really quite nice. You know, you can just literally play around with it until you get something that pleases your eye. So quite a nice, useful thing to be able to do if you were making a logo type. That's what this is quite good for. And then obviously the animated waves you can use elsewhere. But yeah, I mean, there's so much you can do just to play around with this stuff and just set it up the way you want it. Anyway, give it a go. Get it in Cinema 4D and have a play with it and see what you can come up with. But for now, I mean, that just about covers this. But there is one last thing, actually, just one last thing that I want to show you. As you can see, I've left a gap here. And I've done that deliberately because I'm going to copy this divide across and I'm going to change the function to subtract and the input to 2. So I'm going to plumb the point count into the top input there and then plumb this output into the iteration end. I'm also going to change the iteration, the start value here, to 1. That's had the effect of fixing the first and last points of our spline in space. Now, to really demonstrate this, I'm going to use the animatable spline. So if I just go back into here, get a hold of this one, go into my frequency and drop that into the field. Now we've got 0, we're back to 0. Now, if we just change the phase shift, what I'm going to do is get the controller, just set my phase shift to 0, and you can see what's happened. Those two points are now fixed in space. We just undo that and leave it there for our demonstration here, and if we just play, you can see what's happening. So the first and last points are fixed. Now that could be an artistic look that you might want to use on an oscilloscope. It's quite possible that you might. So that's the way that you can achieve that. If you need to do something like that, we'll just bring the amplitude down a little bit more. You know, it's up to you whether you choose to use it. You don't have to, but it's an option if you actually want to. So it was just worth showing you that, just to show that it can actually be done, okay? So that's all you need to do there. Let's just take that text out of the way again. But anyway, that really is just about it for this tutorial. So I hope you've enjoyed this one and that you've learned a little bit more, and you can now see that the formula node is actually quite powerful and quite a useful node to be able to play around with a bit. I mean, there's plenty more formulas out there that you can, or formulae I should say, really, for it's not formulas, is it? It's formulae. there's plenty more formulae out there that you can have a look at and try out with the actual formula node there. You know, have a good play around with it and see what you can come up with. See if you can come up with all kinds of weird and wonderful waves and other things as well. I mean, it's not just for the generating waveforms. You can use the formula node for many, many different things. It's good to sort of be aware that it's there and that it can be a good friend to you. But anyway, that about wraps this one up. So I'll see you very soon on the next one. And if you've enjoyed this tutorial, please subscribe to the channel and please give the video a like. Thanks very much.